I'm from Johannesburg. I was born and raised in Soweto. I studied in Wits University, and I got involved with the IMC Johannesburg Collective 4 years ago. One of the things that we're trying to do is to raise awareness around struggles in the communities, some of the issues that are facing activists both in communities as well as in academic institutions and things like that. So through Indie Media, we did a whole lot of video material that captured most of the significant events in South African community resistance, but also were participating in some of the major battles that were facing the APF, most importantly, but other groupings. Early last year, we got the chance to play around with the idea of a low-power radio station through equipment donated from various sources, including some of the members of the global network of the IMC. We are able to secure a transmitter, it's called a low power transmitter, an antenna and some microphones. And with that equipment, we thought about it as the IMC, about what we could possibly do with it. We called a meeting to get ideas from not only members of the social movements, but also the broader activists, strata in general. That included artists, students, NGO workers and things like that, where we started to talk about the possibility of low power as a way of organizing and extending some of the IMC initiatives. There was an idea that we can't host the station in the city center because of a few reasons. The first one was obviously the safety issue, where in the city center there was much more surveillance, much more observation of activist activities, and closer sort of assessment of what we are doing and things like that. But more importantly, we thought it would be better for a station of this sort that we're thinking about imagining, if it were placed right in the center of community struggles. And in Johannesburg, Gauteng, the main community that had been the biggest affiliate within the APF was the Soweto Electricity Crisis Committee, which organizes mainly in Soweto, which is the biggest township in South Africa, and the one with the most or the longest political history of struggle and resistance. After having chatted to a lot of people, talking about the idea of cleaning it out, possibly having an idea of how the station would look like, what it would involve, what do we need and things like that, we decided to launch the idea of the station. We came up with the name Rasa, which means make a noise. And one of our catchphrases was that we make what we live. Inspired by the words of a late activist struggle hero, Bantu Stephen Biko, in his lines on I write what I like. So the attitude here was that we would use the radio station to voice exactly those voices that are put on the peripheries, artistic voices, activist voices and all others that are pushed to the sides, and put them on the center of what defines a radio station such as this one. I feel the way that we introduced the idea to the community was that we arranged a screening of one of the IMC videos that had been produced. It was called The Fourth World War, and through that we managed to call young kids, MCs, activists, politicians, artists of all sorts and types, intellectuals and NGO types, all types of people came through to have a look at the video, but more importantly to take part in the discussion about the station. one of the major people that were there, or groupings that were there, was a substantial number of the SECC comrades that we work with quite closely in other areas, with Indie Media and APF and so on. And the idea there came out from Comrade Trevor, who suggested that they could actually house the station in Pimville, at the back of his small garage. And the only thing that we needed to secure was that we'd be able to clean up the garage, get it ready, and put it to a level where it looks something like a studio. So that's what we did. Continue.
Yeah, I think we need a little bit of an explanation about the APs,
APF.
The APF and also SS.
SECC.
Yeah, if you could just explain what those are, and I'll change them. And maybe like start about, I mean, for someone who has no idea about the shack dwellers or whatever, and that there's communities in different places.
Yeah.
Okay.
The APF is an organization that is the most in the forefront of community struggles in Johannesburg. It is an emerging social movement that has that arose out of a response from municipal workers that were opposing the new system called the Goli 2000, which was basically a new plan for the Johannesburg city to put itself along commercial and corporate lines, which also included that it would have to get rid of all of its worker facilities, so that all of them would be put into an outsourced entity. At the same time, there were students in the university, especially at Wits University, where a similar policy was being pushed. It was called Wits 2000, where similar ideas were about making sure that the university becomes a competitive, marketable place where you can attract international students on the basis of our competitiveness, where concerns about financial and market-related skills were prioritized, and more schools, especially in the humanities, were collapsed into each other. So, programs were shut down because they were deemed unmarketable or not useful for the corporate interest. Also, students that were from predominantly poor backgrounds had been making demands for greater access into the university. But what the model of this new Wits 2000 was suggesting was that the primary way that the university could raise its own funds was through student fees and user fees of the learners. So it meant that most of the learners that had not the resources to get into university could not be able to do so. The most militant or the most progressive at this stage student organization on campus was an organization called SASCO, South African Students Congress, which was aligned to the ANC. But some of the comrades within SASCO became very vocal about noticing the relationship between these new policies of Ikoli 2000, Wits 2000, and the overall the macroeconomic reorientation of South African society towards the objectives of what is now called the growth, employment and redistribution policy gear. And APF arose out of a need from these various sectors. In communities, people were seeing that, you know, municipal services and things like water and electricity would fall into the ambits of these new corporatized, outsourced companies that would be charging user fees for people that would be able to afford, and those that would not be able to afford would then be cut off and not be given an option. And at this time, the discourse of prepaid services, prepaid water, prepaid electricity, prepaid telephones, prepaid everything was starting to emerge as a way that these new corporatized entities could then make a profit out of service delivery. So APF was coming together, as the name suggests, anti-privatization forum. It was mainly a coming together around some of the problems that privatization poses to some of these things, to students, to workers, to unemployed, to the old people in the townships, to families that were not able to afford a decent standard of living and so therefore could not be able to pay for their services. So it was a coming together of all of those people. The major turning point was when the APF had clearly identified gear as one of the cornerstones of the problems that unite so many people, precisely because of its neoliberal sound and its positioning this neoliberal alternative as the only way to go forward and nothing else. And the APF then rose and began to mobilize and organize in different sectors, especially within communities where we saw an explosion of community movements, organizations that were all civic type organizations, residents associations, unemployed youth organizing themselves, and then a series of workshops and activities and so on made the organization come about almost. And it is through the work that the APF has done and the types of activist identities it has been able to engender that we were able to now have an almost city-wide but also provincial-wide perspective on some of the problems. But beyond that, it also meant that we were able to connect up with other areas in South Africa, particularly in KwaZulu-Natal, where we organized together with the Durban Social Forum an alternative event from what was to be called the World Conference Against Racism, which happened in Durban. And even there, the emerging social movements were beginning to find their voices and beginning to write out certain common agendas of resistance and solidarity building. So as part of how the APF functions, or the emergence of the APF, was that we acknowledge that there are various issues that we need to deal with as an organization. There are various focuses that different communities would have, and the purpose is not to make them one. The idea is to find ways through our diversity and interests to build something that is common amongst us. And thus, the structure of the APF is such that you are able to have what we call the education subcommittee, water privatization research committee. We have a committee for media subcommittee. We've got a committee for local elections, governance, issues like that. We've got an organizing committee and so on. And so in these various committees, then different comrades and activists find their space within the organization and make their interventions in relation to what organizations they stand for and also what are the long-term objectives of it. The nature of discussions and decisions is such that it allows for democratic decision-taking, where we have what we call a coordinating committee, where all of these various subcommittees and things like that come together and they would discuss various things, but they would take the ultimate decision about what the organization does thereafter. Now, the interesting thing is how Indymedia Johannesburg has been able to evolve within the APF itself. Interestingly enough, the Indymedia Collective never saw itself as completely outside of the APF, insofar as most of the Indymedia comrades that were active in Indymedia were also quite active in the media subcommittee of the APF. And thus, all of the discussions around what we produce, how do we produce it, where do we get the resources and things like that, do happen within the Indie Media Collective, but also are opened up to broader participation by the organization as a whole. So it was only fitting then that we, once we had this idea of a low-power radio, that we locate it within that space that has been created, the space that wants to say, you know, alternative media needs to be part of the ways that we engage and resist the forces that are trying to push us down. And Rasa FM then became that possible imaginative space where people could not only just speak about their, you know, their problems and issues about society, but also participate in creating some of the alternatives, making the imaginations come to life, if you like. And that's the power of the Rasa FM. The interesting thing as well is that the radio station also drew in quite a lot of the young people. That often in the organization we would find that, you know, a lot of young people are very keen, they would like to get involved and so on, but their participation had been limited only to the issue of education, because that's one of the biggest issues that are facing young people in Johannesburg, the issue of education, access to education, also the issue of those that are out of school and are unemployed and are therefore not able to get into the education system. So through media, through radio, you could get some of these out of school youths, unemployed young people with these interesting ideas about what they want to create, to then become part of a very organic, alive project that also gives voice to the general, you know, positions that people want to be voicing and that have been shut down by mainstream media. Yeah.
What happened once the radio started in Soweto?
I don't know, something close to magic, basically. That's all I could describe it as. For a long time we had been speaking, workshopping, calling meetings. We called meetings for at least 5 weeks before we even touched the equipment, trying to clarify what the radio station would be, what the programming would look like, how everyone would sort out their times, who's going to be involved with doing what and things like that. So we spent weeks and weeks going to this little garage, starting to clean it up and whatever. But we didn't have a sense of what it would actually be like, given that we had not, none of us at least had been involved in a radio station, let alone having to have the possibility of producing things for the station. It meant that people had to go into libraries, read out on how do you do a program schedule, get people to find out how to interview people, how to find the information in the libraries and things like that. But once the station was started, we launched the station on June 16, 2005. It was an important day that we decided on it. We thought, you know, June 16 has been used thus far as something that celebrates, you know, the attainment of the liberation by youth. There's a heavy reference about the role that youth have played since the Soweto uprisings, and that, you know, the challenges have changed somewhat. So we thought to use the session also to sort of make that political argument, to say actually the conditions of young people in South Africa have not really changed all that much, especially if they are black and from poor backgrounds. So what we had decided, since we didn't have any sense of what we'd be saying on the air, and, you know, like how do we fill the hours that we hoped to fill out in the radio station, we decided to hold the session just before June 16, on June 11, where we invited poets, jazz musicians, artists of all sorts, graffiti artists, biker boys, everyone. We just made a nice session in a courtyard in one of the parks in Diepkloof, where we basically, the plan was to get as much of that session recorded as possible, so that it would be the basis for a show on June 16. So throughout the whole session, we didn't have much equipment. So we had old tape recorders and things like that. But we got people to walk around with notepads. You know, some of the people that have now become the core group of the collective, young kids, between 16 and about 25, walking around with notepads, interviewing people, calling people from the streets, trying to find out what they would want to say about June 16 and things like that. And it was good for us to have a theme. So the approach that we adopted then was about engendering this idea of collectives, breaking down this thing of responsibility so that we all took shared responsibility. In all, we had collectives that were dealing with the technical aspects, the aspects of the station. So people that would be trying to find out how do we make the sound a little better. But also we had people that were dealing with other aspects, like how do we build alliances, for instance, because we were quite aware, even though the idea is explosive and everyone is taken into it, we were quite aware that it was an idea that was a bit that could come down for serious attack by certain people, especially the government and all its authorities. So we created the way that, you know, different people would have different responsibilities. Also, because of the way that the station was going, it meant that we needed to play around with the times that we had. A lot of the people that were part of the collective were still in school. Some of them were still going to university. Others had small jobs, and most were living far. So there were some things that we needed to sort out around that. But the most important way, out of all these things that we set up, you know, these structures to make the station run better and things like that, was also an idea that we wanted to build the idea of Rasa not only as a radio station, Finnish and Clark. What we wanted to build was also an idea of a movement, or seeing Rasa as part of the general movement, not as a separate thing, you know, like a media that is objective and standing aside, but also a subject and an actor in some of the issues that are being tackled by communities. And the entry point that we thought we could enter by is on precisely the issue of free community media. More importantly, also participative forms or models of community media production. And those models do not exist at the moment. What we have in this country, at least about what they see as community radio, is really radios that are legislated by law, but have taken up models of operating that are similar to mainstream radio stations. So their concerns are also linked to some of the commercial radio stations, issues about, you know, listenership, not only just that, but also the marketability of it and the possibility of raising money through it and things like that. For instance, the biggest critique that the young artists that we had included in some of our activities had to say was that, you know, because they are not able to get into studios and record in using fancy equipment, because they are not able to afford to have producers that these people, the mainstream musicians, are getting, then their voices are being shut down. But most importantly as well was the aspect of actually how do these cultures or social activities are chosen. In South Africa, for instance, in terms of music, there's this genre of music, it's called Kwaito, which has been often touted as like a genuine South African creation that expresses the South African subject, especially the youth, urban and radical and things like that. But more and more what we've seen happening to this genre is Americanization of the genre, so that it starts copying some of the aspects of, you know, mainstream R&B of the United States. And as a response to some of that, young people have more and more started to look for outputs or alternatives to that sort of, you know, totalizing culture of, you know, bling bling, superstar, and all of those individuating conceptions. And the rise of hip hop as a cultural form of expression, but also as a social form of interaction between people, especially people that are sharing a certain socio-political orientation, but also an economic position in society. These are young kids that are often, you know, not from well-off backgrounds, that don't necessarily share the values that are being put out by mainstream music, especially Kwaito and the others, or that want to say, no, we choose to express ourselves in a different way. We choose to have different heroes as representations of ourselves. We choose to use spaces that we occupy differently, as opposed to them being some commercial space where we're just fighting about our intellectual rights to the property that we produce. We're saying we can share the knowledge, we can share the production, and the music that we sing is an expression of where we come from, where we are going, but who we are going there with. And that space has not been available to many of these kids. And so that's how we're able then to also break down some of the, you know, the divisions between the social movements, you know, as in the movements that are fighting for the basic services, but also movements of young people, artistic people, movements of intellectuals that are disgruntled by, you know, the way that this whole consumerist hegemony has taken, you know, hold of everyone's imagination and are looking for alternative spaces. So, you know, through the way that we did the programming, we're able to take out some of these things. So we had like programs that were mainly focused on content, which was talk content, and the content was generated by, you know, an idea of finding out some of the issues that were raised. So for instance, we would take an issue that is a burning issue in the social movements, especially in the anti-privatization forum in Johannesburg, which is the issue of water privatization. And then we would want to get different people to give different perspectives on it. And then also draw out some of the knowledge that is out there. Like for instance, get some facts that we may have generated through, you know, the research subcommittee reports by different social actors that have shown that, you know, the effects of privatization of basic life has had on poor communities, and yet at the same time express it through the lived experiences of people that are living in these communities that don't necessarily see themselves as, you know, t-shirt wearing, card carrying members of a social movement, but just members of a community that has been sidelined, and then also finding themselves through that way. So the station was a powerful thing in those regards, because it made us, it also opened up some of our own preconceptions of what we thought we would be doing. Whereas when we first imagined it, we thought it would be like a mouthpiece for the social movements and things like that. What ended up happening really is that the station started defining its own character. And it defined it through the interactions and the voices and the expressions and things like that from different people, so that it sort of generated an identity of its own, like that. Something that is what would be equivalent in commercial or mainstream thinking as branding. In this sense, it was an identity that wasn't linked to some, you know, issue of exchange and yeah, sure.
So what were the biggest fights people had at the station?
Yeah, yes, the station was not a happy, it wasn't like a happy group with no differences. I mean, there were definite differences in terms of orientation. Okay, there were not really too many fights when we started off. I mean, in the first few weeks that we ran, in fact, the first few months actually, the first 3 months, we sort of worked together quite well and things like that. We had a sense of what we were trying to achieve and things like that. But slowly, as we went into this thing, as people got a bit more comfortable and a bit more, you know, sussed with this idea of a radio station, differences started showing up. Some of the differences was the issue of approach. Whereas Rasa FM, we had said, initially when we started it off, we had wanted to create this thing as an alternative form of media and things like that. We would be wanting to get away from some of the mainstream ideas that are out there, but also both in terms of the content, but also in terms of the music. So we would be consciously wanting to find different things. More and more the tensions became about, you know, as we got more people involved in the stations, and people were quite aware of its huge rise in popularity all over the place, then it became the issues of, you know, how do we get ourselves, how do we make use of this popularity that we've just gained? You know, people are saying, you know, they want to hear some of the music that we think is not so great anymore. And more we had to adjust, you know, some of our content so that it would, you know, accommodate the size of the people that have now tuned in. To some extent, you know, there was accommodation, but at some stage there had to be a point where some of us had to say, you know, we must just choose whether or not we want to build this alternative or we want to...
Is that yours or mine?
I think it's yours.
Was there any, what about having commercials? Like, do people want to advertise if it was so popular?
Yes. Then the other thing that was hitting us was the fact that the station did not have any funding whatsoever. We practically were living out of our own pockets, and all of us, I mean, I was unemployed. Most of the people that were in the station were unemployed. There was no way else that we could raise money for instance, a simple thing like a cassette so that we can tape some of the shows that we are having. We couldn't raise that sort of money. We couldn't raise, I mean, people would be sitting at the station from 6 o'clock a.m., which is the time when we arrive, and then all the way until 9 o'clock p.m., and there is no food, you know, then it just became quite depressing insofar as we were not even able to reach, you know, some of the most basic things that could help us do our work better. Thus, you know, the argument for us to become a bit more commercial became that much stronger, because people started saying, you know, if we were to sell advertising space, if we were to sell the shows to some people, then we'd be able to raise some money, in fact, to run some of the things that we needed to do. More and above that, if we were to be a bit more orientated to a wider market, this is the argument. They were saying if we had a wider market, there's a chance that we could have more possibilities for selling it as a way of raising funds for advertisers and things like that. And once that is done, then the station can sustain itself. It can buy CDs if it needs CDs. It can buy all sorts of things. And slowly and surely, I mean, people then became disorientated because it became more of an expense to them, an expense they couldn't afford really because they didn't have the means to afford it. And, you know, the cracks came when Ikasa finally made an appearance on the station. This is after 6 months of successful broadcasting through all of those difficulties that we had been through. One afternoon, a van from the ICASA. ICASA is the regulatory body that looks out for, you know, licensing and frequency allocation and things like that. I think that sort of was the first wave of the lull, let's call it a lull, I don't know what else we can call it, but it was definitely one of the indicators of a sobering up for most of us, whereas we had been so taken by this enthusiasm and excitement for such a long time, and it had kept us going so strongly. The reality was starting to hit at us. We didn't have too many allies either that we can rely on. Say, for instance, if ICASA were to bring police there, people then became a bit more worried about their own futures. What would they tell their parents? What would they say to at home? And then there was this talk about the station being an illegal thing, and more people getting a bit more nervous about the legal status of the station. We had, by the way, the issue of the legality of the station was amongst the first things that we discussed, even before we decided to set up the station. We had approached quite a lot of organizations and things like that around specifically that issue. But the key organization that we were in conversation with was an organization we call the Freedom of Expression Institute. And we sort of solicited some advice around what could be done and, you know, and things like that. But there was an informal agreement between ourselves and FXI that they would assist us, especially around the legality issues, finding the appropriate laws, finding, plan B if anything should happen, especially around providing a lawyer if one of us were to be arrested, or also helping out with the media profiling of the issue should the station come down on fire. Unfortunately though, not much came out of it. So after the first Ikhaza visit, the station became substantially smaller in terms of the number of volunteers that we had at the station, but also in terms of how people perceived it, because not only was that, the onslaught of the station was not only physical. They didn't just come there and say, you are legal and get out. What they also did was that they worked on the psychology of the community as well, to say, using other radio stations that are in Soweto, especially the one station that was called Josie FM, which was the most threatened of all the stations in the region because of precisely the radical stance that Rasa was taking and the third alternative that it was offering, and possibly a threat to their own claim to be a community radio station. So, they used the radio stations, they used the newspapers, they used all the forms of communicating with the the nervous population if it comes to things that are too radical, like what Rasa FM started to be seen as something that is, a bit too radical and a bit illegal. And more the illegality of it became the predominant attitude that people started attaching to the station. So soon it became criminalized almost in some circles because it was labeled a pirate station, and because of its pirate status, then it is a criminal act, and those that are associated with it are criminals and therefore should be locked up in accordance with the law. That's the argument that Ikhaza pushed, and I think to some extent that argument held serious weight in slowing down the progress of the station. We continued nevertheless with the broadcasting. We had to reduce our hours, of course. We had to develop an emergency evacuation procedure in case Ikhaza were to show up, whatever. We sort of had a better sense. We also had to close ourselves out quite substantially as well. Whereas when we started, we were wanting to opening it up and getting everyone involved and da-da-da. We then became a bit more cautious about the information that we were spreading out. We got a bit more careful about who knows what and things like that. So it was also, the visit also was a sort of a self-regulating thing against general, open, participative, models that we tried to follow. Ultimately though, we put up a fight, quite a brave fight, because we stayed on air for another 2 months after the first visit. Albeit we were still, our hours were much less. Instead of broadcasting from 7 to 9 o'clock, we're now broadcasting from 9 a.m. to about 6:30 p.m. and then playing some music from 6:30 to 8 o'clock until the next day. Then our shows became much smaller, much more compact, but also it sort of gave us a sense of, we clarified exactly, the programming. We had a consistent schedule, we had a consistent number of people that were participating, each one of the people that were leading a collective that was producing a particular show would do their own research, find the people to interview, raise the issues they would want to. So even though, our mass participation model had been injured a little, it also helped us also to be a bit more clear about what we were trying to do. And it became more urgent for us, in fact, to start speaking about Rasa, not only as a radio station, because it was quite clear that as a radio station, you know, they can just turn off the power and that's where it ends. But Rasa was more a calling, something that was calling to arms for people to say, you know, this media, these airwaves are ours, you know. Communities have the right to produce things that they deem are relevant to them, that express their desires, that also speak of the types of lives they would like to live, you know, and that is what Rasa would be about, beyond just the physical location of the that one station that we had in Pimvid, but just the idea of a movement that is fast growing, I think, even globally, of low power radio as an alternative form of media access to people, not just access in terms of quotas and, you know, percentages, but real physical participation of people. So, I mean, even though ultimately we were actually shut down, and ICASA went publicly and said, you know, should they find that we were operating or in any way touching any of the equipment that was there, then they would definitely open criminal charges over and above a fine of over R1 million for contravening their regulation. The lesson that we've learned is that, you know, Rasa is not dead. You know, the idea of Rasa is not dead. All of us are still alive, thank goodness, except, yeah, some awful thing happened to one of our members. In fact, he passed away last year. And I think...
On a bicycle?
Yes, no, he got hit by a car. He was the youngest member of Rasa FM and the most vocal and the one that was the biggest challenge to some of my little assumptions also. Sometimes I think, you know, I have the right to speak whenever, but he was like, he was a conscience really, because he was so young and he was coming so well, and he died in the most trivial of ways. And I think a lot of people got very, you know, hurt, or, yeah, it sort of demotivated people even further, you know.
What
not
was
only
his name?
Sihle was his name. Yeah, Sihle, comrade Sihle. We used to call him Tracy Chapman. Yeah, because he always played the Tracy Chapman song at the station. Every time, you know, that he's on the controls, because he would play Tracy Chapman. But I mean, the one thing that I'm grateful for about the station is that, you know, we've been able to create friendships. Friendships that are beyond just, you know, the rhetoric or whatever, like real friends. I think all of the members of the Rasa Collective feel themselves to be part of something special, something that had never been done before, and something that has got explosive potentials that thousands of more people can do and even improve on, you know. But the fact that we were there and we chose to take the risks that we did, and we maintained it for the length of time that we did, even with all those odds against us, sort of solidified the ties amongst us. And I don't think, you know, like, you can chat to anyone that was involved with the Rasa FM, they will tell you that Rasa is still very much alive. And I think it still is. The thing now is to now think about how do we start, you know, learn from what we like, the experiences that we've had, but also how do we also spread it as well? Because the other thing is that the way that the system manages to shut down peripheral voices is by isolating them and individualizing them and making them seem as an odd out of everything else. And the way that we need to respond to it is to build the idea of commonness or a collective. There's many of us all over the world, all over the country, all over the streets, everywhere. There's more of us than there's of them. And the idea of building the radio station could also be a way to build that consciousness that there's far more of us than there could ever be of those that want to shut us down or shut us up. Yeah.
Just tell me what you think the threat is Like, why is that? And that's the threat. I mean, like, what is the difference, for example, between Josie FM and Rasa?
No, I mean, there's a trend at the moment. I don't know if it is a cancellation. I mean, it's a systematic erasal of our history, something, a rewriting of what we understand ourselves to be. Whereas there was in the whole period of our parents' struggle and their parents' struggle had always been about reclaiming the liberty of the African peoples as a people. There's this new trend that is coming out of the African subject, not only as an individual, but more importantly as a customer. All of us are becoming customers. Even the way that we understand community media is also taking into the account that, you know, we are customers of this radio station or customers of the other station. So the threat they have is anything that wants to work against the grain of this, you know, hegemonizing new awareness of, you know, all of us are separate, our problems are separate, and things like that. So even Josie FM itself, even though it poses itself as a community media, community radio station, it uses exactly the same corporate formula of management and administration as any private radio station does. And what that does is that, one of their complaints was that, you know, if we do this thing the way that we're doing it, we could be tapping into their market base, you know, then their marketers or people that are buying advertising from them may be a bit concerned about the numbers now shifting from them and then listening to this alternative station, which these advertisers don't have access to because the station is opposed to some of the issues that these marketers want to adopt. So, I mean, their pressure was that, you know, now we have this license, and this license is the only thing that gives us, we are the only ones that have got the right to produce the media for this community. We are the only ones that have got the right to, you know, create an understanding of people's positions and experiences. And anyone else that goes, you know, that almost poses an alternative attitude is a threat directly to our own existence and should be shut down by the use of the most brutal of forces, the police and whoever, and their authorizing authorities, you know, like these are ICASA people, which are really like police in suits. That's all they do. You know?
So, but isn't, what about the free market?
That's it there, you know, we are customers to the free market. The free market has become, you know, the end all and be all of existence. All of us relating to each other, not only as individuals, but more importantly as exchangeable goods. You know, the value of our lives is based on the value of the pockets that we have, and the way that we value the next person is how much they can contribute to us monetarily, you know, in terms of how much money they can they are worth. So, I mean, that whole, and there's nothing like, you know, free, creative living and being and you know, breathing and being friends and valuing things and creating things and sharing them, you know. All of that is being shut off. Where now, today in Soweto, I can promise you there are people fighting and beating each other up because somebody else used the tap and was drinking water from that tap, because water is now a private thing, you know. So, you know, so it's like an attack to the very core of our own existence, you know, a challenge to defining who we are and what living is about, you know. Yeah, sure.
But it seems so contradictory that they don't want to have any competition to Josie FM, and yet they want to have,
they want to have competition for Josie FM, but competition that plays along their framework of what competitive things, a competition for, you know, consumers, you know, a competition that does not undermine the very thinking of the way the system should function. For instance, if I were a multimillionaire and I went there and I said I wanted to open a pay channel, a radio channel, this, that, I have this sponsor, I have APSA, I have whatever these big companies, MTN, Voda World, BP Petroleum, and all of those people. I would bet you I would get that license better than if I were to be there and say, you know, we are there because we're wanting to say participative production by communities themselves. It's less fashionable, if you like, or less, I mean, it's more of a threat to them, the fact that you're not, you know, embracing this new, you know, logic that has come out. Yeah.